Your faith. Jesus said that if I fear, I should come to him. No one else can be my shield, I should come to him. For the Lord is good and faithful, he will keep us day and night. We can always run to Jesus, Jesus strong and kind.
church, arise and put your armor on. Hear the call of Christ our captain. For now the weak can say that they are strong in the strength that God has given.
Good morning. Welcome to Resurrection Lutheran Church for worship today. Today is the third Sunday in the season of Pentecost. It's also the day that we celebrate the presentation of the Augsburg Confession. And for a little bit on that, check out the inside back cover of your service folder. The service is outlined for you in your service folder. We'll begin with our opening hymn, number 711, Jesus Calls Us Over the Tumult. Also, a special welcome to those joining us through YouTube today. The bulletin is down in the show notes. God bless your worship. Continue on the inside front cover of your service folder. Please rise.
Thank you.
We join to confess our sins. Almighty and merciful Father, we have strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed what we have devised and desired in our hearts. We have offended you and sinned against your holy law. We have done those things that we should not have done, and we have left undone those things that we should have done. Have mercy on us, Lord. Spare us, forgive us, and restore us according to your promises in Christ Jesus. Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again. God demonstrated his own love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Through his life, death, and resurrection, our Lord Jesus Christ has removed your guilt forever. By his command and authority, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We pray. O God, the strength of all who trust in you, mercifully hear our prayers. Be gracious to us in our weakness, and give us strength to keep your commandments in all we say and do. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated for the reading of God's Word. Our first reading from 1 Kings chapter 19, beginning in verse 15. We see that Elisha commits himself completely to the work to which the Lord had called him, leaving family and wealth behind. Then the Lord said to him, that is to Elijah, "Go back the way you came and go to the wilderness of Damascus. When you get there, you are to anoint Hazael as king over Aram. You will also anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, as king over Israel, and Elisha, son of Shaphat, from Abel-Meholah, as prophet in your place. Whoever escapes the sword of Hazael, Jehu will kill, and whoever escapes the sword of Jehu, Elisha will kill. But I have preserved in Israel 7,000, whose knees have not bent to Baal, and whose lips have not kissed him." So Elijah went from there and found Elisha, son of Shaphat. Elisha was doing the plowing with 12 teams of oxen in front of him, and he himself was driving the 12th team. Elisha crossed over to him and threw his cloak over him. Then Elisha left the oxen and ran after Elijah. He said, "Let me kiss my father and my mother goodbye, then I will follow you." Then Elijah said, "Go back, for what have I done to you?" So Elisha turned back from following him. Then he took the team of oxen and slaughtered them. Using the equipment from the oxen as fuel, he cooked the meat and gave it to the people, and they ate. Then he got up, followed Elijah, and served him. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our small catechism selection today, the sixth petition to the Lord's Prayer, we join in this together. And lead us not into temptation. What does this mean? God indeed tempts no one. But we pray in this petition that God would guard and keep us so that the devil, the world, and our flesh may not deceive us nor seduce us into false belief, despair, and other great shame and vice. Though we are attacked by these things, we pray that still we may finally overcome them and gain the victory. Our second reading from Philippians chapter 1, beginning in verse 18. Jesus showed his grace to Paul so that Paul could rejoice in every circumstance. Grace creates committed followers. Paul writes, "I want you to know, brothers, that the things which happened to me actually took place to advance the gospel. And so it has become clear throughout the whole palace guard and to all the rest that I am in chains because of Christ. And through my chains, the majority of the brothers in the Lord have become much more confident about daring to speak the word of God fearlessly. Some preach Christ out of envy and rivalry, and others out of goodwill. The latter do so out of love, knowing that I am placed here for the defense of the gospel. The former proclaim Christ out of selfish ambition, not sincerely, but thinking they can cause trouble for me while I am in chains. What does it matter? only this, that in every way, whether for outward appearance or for the truth, Christ is being proclaimed, and in this I rejoice. Yes, and I will continue to rejoice, because I know that this will turn out for my deliverance through your prayer and the support of the Spirit of Jesus Christ. This matches my earnest expectation and hope that I will in no way be put to shame, but with all boldness, as always, so even now, Christ will be magnified in my body, whether by life or by death. Yes, for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. But if I am to go on living in the flesh, that will mean fruitful labor for me. Yet which should I prefer? I do not know. I am pulled in two directions, because I have the desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far. But it is more necessary for your sake that I remain in the flesh. And since I am convinced of this, I know that I will remain and will continue with all of you for your progress and joy in the faith. And so by my coming to you again, my goal is to give you even more reason to boast in Christ Jesus. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our gospel acclamation today from Mark chapter 8, we read this responsively. Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves,
take up their cross, and follow me.
Please rise for the reading of our gospel. Our gospel reading from Luke chapter 9, this will also be the basis for our sermon today. Jesus teaches that following him means leaving the world behind. When the days were approaching for him to be taken up, Jesus was determined to go to Jerusalem. He sent messengers ahead of him. They went and entered a Samaritan village to make preparations for him. But the people did not welcome him because he was determined to go to Jerusalem. When his disciples James and John saw this, they said, "Lord, do you want us to call down fire from heaven to consume them?" But he turned and rebuked them. "You don't know what kind of spirit is influencing you. For the Son of Man did not come to destroy people's souls, but to save them." Then they went to another village. As they went on their way, a man said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." Jesus said to him, "Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head." He said to another man, "Follow me." But he said, "Lord, first let me go and bury my father." Jesus told him, "Let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God." Another man also said, "I will follow you, Lord, but first let me say goodbye to those at my home." Jesus told him, "No one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The first part of our confession of faith today, as printed on the next page, excerpts from the Augsburg Confession, Part 1, we read this responsively. It is with one accord taught and held that there is one divine essence which is named God and truly is God, but there are three persons in the same one essence, equally powerful, equally eternal, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit.
All three are one divine essence, eternal, undivided, unending, of immeasurable power, wisdom, and goodness, the creator and preserver of all visible and invisible things.
It is taught among us that since the fall of Adam, all human beings who are born in the natural way are conceived and born in sin. That this means that from birth they are full of evil lust and inclination and cannot by nature possess true fear of God and true faith in God.
Moreover, this same original sin is truly sin, and condemns to God's eternal wrath all who are not, in turn, born anew through baptism and the Holy Spirit.
Likewise, it is taught that God the Son became a human being, born of the Virgin Mary, and that the two natures, the divine and the human, are so inseparably united in one person that there is one Christ.
He is true God and true human being, who truly was born, suffered, was crucified, died, and was buried, in order both to be a sacrifice, not only for original sin, but also for all other sins, and to conciliate God's wrath.
Moreover, the same Christ descended into hell
truly rose from the dead on the third day and ascended into heaven, is sitting at the right hand of God, in order to rule and reign forever over all creatures, so that through the Holy Spirit he may make holy, purify, strengthen, and comfort all who believe in him, also distribute to them life and various gifts and benefits, and shield and protect them against the devil and sin. Finally, the same Lord Christ will come in full view of all to judge the living and the dead. It is taught that we cannot obtain forgiveness of sins and righteousness before God through our merit, work, or satisfactions, but that we receive forgiveness of sins and become righteous before God out of grace, for Christ's sake through faith, when we believe that Christ has suffered for us, and that for his sake our sin is forgiven, and righteousness and eternal life are given to us. For God will regard and reckon this faith as righteousness in his sight. To obtain such faith, God instituted the office of preaching, giving the gospel and the sacraments. Through these, as through means, he gives the Holy Spirit, who produces faith where and when he wills in those who hear the gospel. You may be seated for our next hymn, number 630, Thy Strong Word.
Thank you.
fellow redeemed. We consider briefly our gospel reading from the Gospel of Luke chapter 9, especially the first portion, verses 51 through 54. And as we begin looking at that, the question from James and John, these brothers that were nicknamed the Sons of Thunder, perhaps for their rocky and impetuous personalities, for things just like this. Jesus and his disciples are traveling from Galilee down to Jerusalem. And they didn't have to go through Samaria. There was a perfectly good highway that went around it, but Jesus wanted to. And there are James and John. When the next town says, "No thanks, Jesus, we want you to go somewhere else, we don't need you here," there are James and John. "Lord, do you want us to call down fire on them from heaven?" Wow. I mean, it's almost the same attitude that they had when they and their mother came and said, "Lord, can we sit on your right and on your left?" It's this attitude that says, what I want and what I need is whatever I want to happen right now. But just maybe, before we entirely dismiss them, maybe we take a moment to consider. Consider that maybe there is an element of truth and that they were a little bit correct. Here is Jesus bringing the word of life. And here is Jesus, the very Son of God. And James and John, putting the best construction on it, James and John certainly knew this and loved this fact and appreciated it. And what else did the Samaritans deserve? What else would they deserve for completely rejecting the Son of God? What else would they deserve if God is the very one who 1,400 years previously had appeared to his people with fire and cloud and earthquake and lightning and the sound of trumpets there at Mount Sinai? And here were the Samaritans treating it like it's no big deal. "Well, Jesus, we saw the rest of your travel itinerary, and no thanks. Jesus, we saw that you're a Bears fan. You're on your way to Chicago, and so no thanks." You kind of understand what Peter and, well, what James and John are saying. As they're saying, "Lord, can you call down, do you want us to call down fire from heaven on these people for rejecting you?" They have a love and an understanding of who this Jesus is. But even more, they have an understanding of what his holiness entails. That God had appeared to his people, that God had chosen to walk with his people, that God had even come in order to save his people. And there was this village saying, "No, no thanks." And before we get to anything else that we're talking about today, we have to at least understand this fact that this isn't some ambivalent action that they are carrying out. This isn't some, well, take it or leave it, you know, different attitudes for different people, different mindsets, and everybody is entitled to his or her own opinion. No way. Not when it comes to what God says, and not when it comes to the appearance of holy God among his people. Like, that's an idea that creeps in so easily. And that's an idea that we subscribe to so easily. That what I want and what I decide and my own personal boundaries of my freedoms are things that nobody can really touch. But when God shows up, what do they say? "No, thank you." The people did not welcome him because he was determined to go to Jerusalem. And what other answer is there than fire from heaven? This outright rejection of the very Son of God. What other answer is there to the arrogance of the human heart that says, "I know better and I don't want what you have to offer"? We have to at least see the value and the understanding of James and John here. that at first blush, you read that and it's like, whoa, that's a little much, don't you think? Let's dial it back a little bit. But realistically, that's exactly what the Samaritans deserved. Realistically, that's exactly what every heart deserves when it says, I know better, and I want what I want, and I want it now. But there's more. Because here are James and John. Perhaps they know enough about the truth of God, and they have heard Jesus preach enough that they know exactly who he is. And they see their role and the part that they have in the proclamation of the gospel, that they are involved in the ministry that Jesus carries out. And they understand, at the very least, they have some beginning of an understanding on the deep and eternal impact that these words would have. And perhaps it kind of gets to their head. And I guess that's the other side. The other side, where they've got enough understanding about the Word of God, and they've got enough understanding so that they can cloak and project the image that they are doing this for a good and godly reason. That maybe there is still that animosity between these two ethnic groups living next to each other, and at the very least, all it took was one excuse, and then we can let them have it. And you don't have to look very far to see echoes of that one as well. When your personal beliefs, or beliefs that are even scriptural beliefs, are verified in the public square, when the Word of God is upheld, or when the Word of God is attacked, it is very easy to say, now I've got the reason, and now I've got the justification to completely go on the attack, to shut down any discussion, and to say, now is the time for judgment to happen. Now is the time for the error to be corrected, and now is the time when this person is really going to hear what they need to know. That it even happens with us, that it still happens with us, to know what God has to say, and to use that not as the proclamation and the basis for sharing the Word of God, but as the reason to speak up with an attitude that says, now I finally get to at least correct this wrong a little bit. And I finally get to speak to exactly what has been bothering me and for a long time. And I get to use God's Word as the excuse, the fall boy. That if they reject what I'm saying, it's not because I'm saying it with such anger and vigor, but it's because they're rejecting the Word of God. That perhaps James and John let their own emotions grab hold of their hearts. And it might be construed as a good thing, reverence for a holy God. And they can hide behind that and say, Lord, now's the time. And inwardly, the sinful heart says, oh boy, it is the time. So there's some of that going on, back and forth. There's the first element of understanding that rejecting the Word of God and rejecting what our Lord has to say is a dangerous thing, and maybe a little dose of reality, that when God's Word is rejected, God is serious about that, and the judgment that he holds off as a judgment that is still coming. And that a sinful rejection of the Word of God is just as deserving of fire and brimstone as the entire city of Sodom and Gomorrah. And on the other hand, trying to parse out our emotions and our own feelings and how even our sinful flesh knows how to use the Word of God and hide behind the Word of God so that we can make it look like I'm concerned about the Word of God when really I'm most concerned about getting my way. I'm most concerned about winning the argument. So there's those things that are going on in the background. But I think we also see what Jesus has to say.
how he responds. Lord, do you want us to call down fire from heaven to consume them? But he turned and rebuked them. You don't know what kind of spirit is influencing you, for the Son of Man did not come to destroy people's souls, but to save them. That Jesus reserves for himself that final judgment, and he calls his Christians to speak. And that's exactly what we celebrate today. On June 25th, 1530, the Lutherans were finally called to speak, and they had been working on this project for a long time. And this took place in Germany, in a place called Augsburg. June 25th, 1530, the ruler of all of Europe is there. And he's also been called the head of the political church, because there's this intertwining of the responsibilities of the church and the state is what's going on. Charles V there is sitting on the throne, and he's overseeing this church council because he's also overseeing the politics attached to it. He oversees what is called the Holy Roman Empire. And there are these people up in Germany who are saying they don't want to be part of his empire. Well, they do, but they don't want to be part of his church. And so he calls this group of people together all the way from Rome up to, you know, northern Germany and to the very edge of Europe, the eastern edge. And he calls them all together, and it's kind of a debate. Do we want it all in Latin, which is the language of the church? And that's what Charles V wanted. If we just read it all in Latin, then the common people won't know what we're talking about, and we can just take care of the politics, and we can straighten out this disagreement. And the Lutheran princes there at Augsburg, they said no. We have come to read a statement of faith that would also provide the legal justification for them to exist. This was a tense moment because they had to provide a theological reason for their political state to exist. And that if they had failed, then they would have ignited a civil war at the very least. Or even more desperately, they would have lost the truth of the Word of God and been coerced to remain within the Roman Catholic Church. And so this is a document, the Augsburg Confession, which we have a few excerpts from today. This is a document that is both a statement of faith, this is what we believe, as well as a legal document saying this is the case that we are presenting before the court. And as these Lutheran princes gathered together before Charles V, and they stood there, and Charles V said, all right, let's have it in Latin, because it's a church affair. And then, by the way, the people outside who have all gathered to listen, they won't understand a word of what we're saying. All the Lutheran governors, you could say, that's kind of the equivalent, all the Lutheran governors stood up together, and they had their representative read it in German, the language of the people, so that they would understand the theological reason, the biblical basis for why we believe what we believe. To stand up and say that we are confessing the truth in a language that you can understand, so that you can know not only what you believe, but also why. And they stood and they read the entire Augsburg Confession. It was probably a good 25 or 30 minutes worth. And that was really the birthday of the Lutheran Church, June 25th of 1530. Because that Augsburg Confession would be the basis and the reason why those Lutheran princes, or, you know, governors in our terminology, the reason why those Lutheran princes would be able to have Lutheran churches within their lands, while still remaining under the umbrella of the Holy Roman Empire. And where does this fit with our gospel reading? Because it's easy to get distracted, to let our emotions get in the way. And it's easy to get distracted and think that I am saying the right thing for the right reason. But here, there at Augsburg, and even here today, Jesus doesn't call us to be the final judge and jury. He calls us to be faithful with our proclamation, faithful with what we say, both individually and as a church body and as a congregation. He calls us to be faithful in what we do so that by what we do, we also confess that truth of this is what we believe. And that convention at Augsburg perhaps reminds us of that fact, that the truth of God's word isn't something simply reserved to those who have gone to school for 8 years or more, but it's something that each of us has in our hands. And because each of us has that truth of God's word, each of us has that same responsibility to confess it faithfully. And boy, there are times when that temptation of James and John really, really shows up. There are times when there's a strong temptation to finally say everything that I haven't said for a long time, everything that I've been afraid to say, because now it looks like the power and the might is on my side and I don't have anything to be afraid of. Now it looks like now is the time when I will finally win the argument and I can be a little bit more straightforward about what we believe and why, because now I don't have any fear of failure. Is that possible? Or does that happen? Does that happen where Christians, maybe for a long time, you've avoided that person, you've avoided that conversation, you've kind of kept quiet to yourself and said, well, if I just keep it to myself, then it's my own personal belief and nobody else is going to squabble with me about what I believe. Is it possible that you've avoided the conversation because it would take a little bit more effort of listening and understanding and having to exercise some care and some patience? Or the other direction, when events change and you feel more like the right and the power is on your side, that all of a sudden, it's a lot easier to speak. Take, for instance, the announcement that came, well, one of the announcements that came from this session of our Supreme Court, where they said that this federal ruling wasn't really a federal ruling, that it should be something discussed in the states. And every discussion board online is now just a dumpster fire of arguments back and forth. And how many Christians that I know have, you know, spoken in favor of life from its very beginning to its natural end, how many Christians now feel like they've got all the rights and all the ability to say everything that they haven't said? And how many times that degrades into the personal attack, our own modern version of, do you want me to call down fire on these people because I don't like them, but now I've got the excuse to hide behind the truth? And the human heart hasn't changed very much, no, has it? Where the effort of needing to speak with somebody and the responsibility on the Christian to speak with somebody, that is pushed aside when it looks like we've got the ability to speak, and boy oh boy, now I've got 5 out of 9 justices on my side too, and so I should. And where is the Christian confession? Where is the Christian confession when Christians only speak up because we think the politics match with our beliefs? Where is the Christian confession when our children need to be instructed in the Word of God?
And they need to be instructed in a word of God that is, yes, in the context of a nation that calls itself Christian, but they will be growing up in a world that will be completely anti-Christian, even more than it is today. Where is the Christian confession of the Lutherans who stood together there at Augsburg and said, this is what we believe, and this is the legal basis for why. And I'm going to stand here rather than give up on even one element of what I believe. Where is the Christian confession that Jesus encourages when he says, friends, it's not time for fire, it's time to talk. When he says, friends, you don't know what kind of spirit is influencing you. The Son of Man did not come to destroy people's souls, but to save them. Because that's the core of it. That's the heart of it here. James and John are so caught up in what they want, and they are so caught up in their sense of being right, and they are so caught up in how they think God should act. I want to see the glory now. I want to see the conversions now. I want to see the baptisms now. I want to see these villages bow the knee in worship, or boy, oh boy, are they going to get it if they don't. Boy, oh boy, we are correct. And we're on the side of right. And now's my time to say, Jesus, time to send some fire. That attitude that does not understand in the least how God's kingdom works. The attitude that wants fire and brimstone, but doesn't see where that brimstone ought to be directed. And Jesus says, dear Christian, he came for you. He came for your soul too. He came to reform your life and to change your heart, not through external edicts and laws and controls, but through this word of God. He came to bring faith through this same word of God, attached to water and holy baptism, or attached to the elements here, where he wants to work from the inside out to change your heart and to change your life. And that doesn't always look as flashy and spectacular as the other ways that God has chosen to act. And it doesn't always go as quickly as we might hope. But that's exactly what Jesus encourages here. He says that this is how the kingdom of God is. It is not a matter of your own perception and your own seeing. It is not a matter of establishing a worldly utopia. It's a matter of God sending his spirit to each individual heart so that over time, through contact with the word of God, that word of God shapes the action and gives confidence to the confession so that the Christian will say, how? How can I serve my Lord who has given me everything? That I can serve him best, maybe, yes, by providing a clear and careful witness to the truth in whatever public square the Lord gives me, a carefully worded Facebook post, and I mean, for me, I just share those who write better than I do. You scroll through mine. But the purpose here isn't to bring about and change the world. The purpose here is to be so engrossed with and in love with the Word of God that Jesus builds a church within your own heart, and that each of us is like one more brick in his church and his work here. That, you know, the attitude of James and John says, I want to see a change now, and I want to be able to measure the reaction, and boy, oh boy, if it doesn't happen on my timeline, then it's time for judgment. And the way Jesus responds to them is that he says, you know, you have to be a little bit more patient with the word of God, yet persistent in sharing it. You have to be a little bit more patient in how God continues to work, and yet faithful in using that word. Because the time hasn't come, at least not yet,
for fire and brimstone. And looking in the mirror, thank God for that. That Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem for you and for me, to make you his very own, to wash away your sin, and to address even that heart that wants to hide behind his word. And Jesus has said, dear friend, do you see how your God works? Not in the flashy and spectacular fire from heaven, but in the suffering and the painful groaning of a man on a cross. Dear Christian, do you see how your God works? Not in the flashy and spectacular fire from heaven, but in a taste and a little drink where God hides his forgiveness and yet gives it to each individual believer. That's the God we worship, who opens our eyes to say, you know, this is the attitude where you can be passionate about truth, and you can be passionate about what you believe, but don't let that passion overtake the patience of our God, who wants people to be saved through this same word. Amen. We continue at the bottom of page 5 onto page 6 with the rest of our confession of faith and then the prayer of the church. Please rise. It is also taught that at all times there must be and remain one holy Christian church. It is the assembly of all believers, among whom the gospel is purely preached, and the holy sacraments are administered according to the gospel. For it is enough for the true unity of the Christian church that the gospel is preached harmoniously according to a pure understanding, and the sacraments are administered in conformity with the divine word. We teach that baptism is necessary, that grace is offered through it, and that one should also baptize children, who through baptism are entrusted to God and become pleasing to him. Concerning the Lord's Supper, it is taught that the true body and blood of Christ are truly present under the form of bread and wine in the Lord's Supper, and are distributed and received by mouth there. Concerning confession, we teach that private absolution should be used often. However, it is not necessary to enumerate all misdeeds and sins, since it is not possible to do so. Concerning repentance, it is taught that those who have sinned after baptism obtain forgiveness of sins whenever they come to repentance, and that absolution should not be denied to them by the church. True repentance is nothing else than to have contrition and sorrow, or terror about sin, and yet at the same time to believe in the gospel and absolution that sin is forgiven and grace is obtained through Christ. Concerning church government, it is taught that no one should publicly teach, preach, or administer the sacraments without a proper call. Concerning church regulations made by human beings, it is taught to keep those that may be kept without sin, and that serve to maintain peace and good order in the church, such as specific celebrations and festivals. This is a summary of what is preached and taught in our churches for proper Christian instruction and the comfort of consciences, as well as for the improvement of believers. This teaching is clearly grounded in Holy Scripture and is, moreover, neither against nor contrary to the universal Christian church. And we pray, God of our salvation, when your Son set his face to go to Jerusalem and the cross, his zeal would not be deterred. Grant us to pray with the same fervor and boldness, trusting that you hear us for the sake of the Son of Man. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of the church, you give pastors and church workers to proclaim your steadfast love, to announce freedom from the yoke of slavery to sin, and to point all toward the cross of Christ. Bless their faithful work, that their labor in the Lord may never be in vain. Send workers into your harvest field, for the harvest is plentiful. Lord, in your mercy. God of compassion, you established the family to be a place of protection and growth. Grant that our homes would never become a stumbling block to the kingdom of God, but that they would serve to foster within us the fruit of the Spirit. Lead us to see children as a blessing from you, not a burden. Give us words to speak up for the helpless, as well as the means and opportunity to support those in need. Lord, in your mercy. God of refuge, your salvation draws near to all who trust in you. Grant peace to your people and show us your salvation. Do not let the freedom we have in the gospel become an excuse for sin and vice, but an opportunity for love and service. Hear our petitions for healing, strength, and comfort for all for whom we pray. Be near them as a refuge of the weary and the God who preserves his people. We ask these as we join to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good and right that we should at all times and in all places give you thanks, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who guides his church to confess his name before thrones, powers, emperors, and authorities. Therefore, with all the saints on earth and hosts of heaven, we praise your holy name and join their glorious song. Jesus Christ, in the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. O Christ, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us and grant us your peace. Amen. The congregation is invited forward at the direction of our usher.
We continue with the Song of Simeon on page 7. Please rise. Thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
His mercy endures forever.
We give thanks, O Lord, for your body and blood in this sacrament.
You have clothed us again with the righteousness of Jesus.
By your Spirit, help us to live as your holy people until that day when we feast with you in heaven.
Give us unity within your church, that we may encourage one another in faith, in hope, in love, and in life.
The Lord blesses you and keeps you. The Lord makes his face shine upon you and is gracious to you. The Lord looks upon you with his favor and gives you peace.
The grace of the Lord Jesus be with God's people. Amen.
You may be seated for our final hymn, number 824. This is the Threefold Truth. morning to you all. Special welcome to those guests worshiping with us today. As far as announcements, they are listed for you there. Register for VBS, that's coming up in just under a month. And then July 10th, no 9 a.m. worship service here. You can attend a 9 a.m. worship service out at Hosanna or attend 11 o'clock here. And for those watching on YouTube, July 10th will be an 11 a.m. live stream. And then thirdly, as I was driving out to serve the vacancy at Hosanna on last Sunday, I received a call from a church up in Crivitz, Wisconsin, which is a community of like 60,000 people in the two counties nearby. Church is Grace Lutheran Church in Crivitz, Wisconsin. And then on Wednesday, I also received a call to a dual parish up in Alberta. If you know where Banff National Park is, it's about an hour from there. two churches there in Red Deer and Wetaskiwin, Alberta. We'll talk about that a little bit more during the Family Bible Hour today, because there's a few more details and kind of the way our system works. But I think my response and in my communication with our circuit pastor and our district president was that it would take, you know, that resurrection is at a point in time where changing pastors probably wouldn't be a good thing. So it would take a pretty high level of congregational need for that to happen. But we still have to think it through and give it some careful consideration. Anyway, we'll talk about that during our Family Bible Hour today, because I preached a little long and it's already almost quarter after, and I know the coffee's ready. God bless your week.
Freedom, my steadfast love, my dear.